Darling Thomas. He should be our hero. The great thing is, Thomas is an example for all of us. The news he heard about Jesus being alive was incredible and not credible. How could anyone believe that the man they had seen crucified on Friday was alive again on Sunday? We have the rest of this story to inform our impression of Thomas as a doubter instead of a person of abiding faith. We know that Jesus did, in fact, rise from the dead. We've been celebrating his victory over the grave for 2,000 years, and we've been pointing fingers at Thomas for his doubt. Instead of being critical of him, though, maybe we should be grateful. Grateful that he had the courage to admit his doubts. Grateful that he gave us the example of someone who needed more evidence and more time to accept the news. And grateful that his friends didn't ostracize him for his skepticism. What we have in this story is a beautiful picture of what it is to be a community of faith where all people can learn and grow at their own pace and in their own way. We aren't all in the same place in our life journeys. We haven't all had the same experiences. We don't all process information in the same ways. The other disciples had already encountered the risen Christ. Thomas came into the room a bit late and missed that first visitation. Instead of calling him too little too late, Thomas, and sending him away as a loser that missed out on the event of a lifetime, the disciples continued to include him in their inner circle. In time, Thomas came to the same awareness as the rest of the group. It took him a week longer, but he had his own epiphany and his own encounter with Jesus. That's our job as the church, and our incredible blessing as the people safely welcomed into the church. We create space, safe, sacred space, for each of us to have room to grow. Instead of making each other feel ashamed or weak or some other negative emotion, we accept that faith is a journey with lots of twists and turns, with detours and interruptions, with sharp bends, backtracking, getting lost, and finding our way again. The beautiful, amazing irony of faith is, the more we grow to trust God, the more deeply we believe, the more we're able to admit we have questions, and that sometimes we have more questions than answers. Church is not the place to come to get all our questions answered. It is the place we come to have our questions honored and to find encouragement to continue seeking answers for ourselves. Because the answers that work for me might not be the ones you need, just like Thomas. He needed to have his own encounter with Jesus because the encounter of his friends couldn't vicariously satisfy his serious doubts that were based in very strong logic. When we're honest with ourselves, I think we can find a little of Thomas in each of us. And when we're authentically being followers of Christ, we can find some of the other disciples within ourselves too. We have our own doubts and questions. We need to learn some things for ourselves. We need to explore our faith instead of just buying into the faith of our ancestors. As co-journeyers on this path of life, we need to be willing to acknowledge that same struggle in each other. The church, when it's functioning as it should, is a place where seekers are welcome. It isn't a place filled with homogenized minds that all have identical ideas and parrot back matching sentences to describe our faith. Knowing phrases isn't faith, it's memorization. we can memorize without internalizing. Little kids learn the alphabet song long before those sounds have any meaning to them. They aren't done with their education when they can sing all the way from A, B, C, D, E, F, G, past elemental P to X, Y, Z. They need to learn that those letters represent sounds, and the letters can be put together in specific combinations to create words, and those words convey meanings, and words can be organized into thoughts, and from there we can understand our world and our own place in it. In the same way, Christians don't just memorize a few pieces of scripture and some pat answers like, God said it, I believe it, that settles it. We don't pull a passage out of scripture and use it out of context without understanding its full meaning to control our own life or to seek to control the life of others. As the church, we do learn some basic truths. Then we learn how to apply them to our lives. And then we dig deeper for more meaning and more truth. We listen for the still speaking voice of God to expand our understanding and our awareness. We seek always our entire lives. We are seekers with doubts and questions, looking for ways to live more like Christ. Some of you have already heard the story I'm about to tell. I apologize for being repetitious, but it was a big reminder for me, so I'm going to share it again. There's a thing called confirmation bias. It's a trick our brains pull on us. When we read something or listen to someone speak or observe a situation, we see, hear, and experience what we expect to see, hear, or experience. Unless we are aware of our own biases and we intentionally look for more than confirmation of those preconceived notions, everything we see just reinforces what we already know. So we watch the news, and our opinions of the people in the news aren't changed or challenged regardless of what the reporter is telling us about that person. We either celebrate their accomplishment, or we make an excuse for them, or we blame biased reporting for trying to make them look bad, instead of taking in a piece of information, analyzing it, and attempting to determine whether this new information should cause a shift in our thinking. We do the same thing when we read our scriptures. Are we reading to reinforce what we already believe, or are we reading for the possibility of transformation? Do we want to find a new nugget of golden truth, or do we want to justify an attitude we've been holding on to tightly? Friday morning, I was making myself breakfast. I had zucchini and yellow squash that I shredded to make hash browns. No matter how long you cook them, they never become golden like potatoes. But they are a nice way to increase vegetables in my diet, and they go really well with eggs. I wanted them to look more pleasing though, so I was going to use my favorite trick. Paprika adds great color and can make them a lot more appealing. But my paprika was not where it belonged on the spice shelf. I was getting pretty frustrated searching for it. I have lots of spices, so there were lots of jars to scan. I finally spotted a jar with that distinctive color hiding behind another jar. So I picked it up, glanced quickly at the label, and smiled because I had found my missing paprika. As I turned to the stove, I thought, this is really bright red, and the jar's fuller than I remembered. Emily must have used up the other jar and opened a new one. This bright color will make the hash browns look even better. Encouraged by the beautiful spice, I shook and I shook and I shook it all over the contents of that pan. Cooked a few more minutes, fixed my plate, and carried it and my coffee and my glass of water to the table, ready to savor some awesome deliciousness. My first bite of zucchini had a little surprise. I don't usually think of paprika as adding a lot of flavor, just color. But there was a distinctive hint of pepper flavor to the hash browns. Undaunted and unwarned, I took a second, larger bite from a more colorful pile of squash. As my mouth was flooded with the unexpected heat of that paprika, my mind finally said, I wonder if I read that jar wrong. So I got up, walked back to the spices, selected the same jar from its half-hidden location, and sure enough, instead of the word paprika on the label, it very clearly said cayenne. Now those words don't look a bit alike. Yet in my desire to find paprika, I managed to see the word I was seeking instead of the word that was printed. I read with confirmation bias, and even when the volume in the jar and the brightness of the contents didn't match what I was expecting, I allowed my bias to override the facts. I needed to be a doubting Thomas. I needed to allow space for my own questions. I needed to do more exploring before making my decision and committing to that jar of spice. As the church, as followers of Christ, as people on a journey of faith and a life journey, we need to celebrate doubt. We need to question. We need to wonder. And we need to encourage each other to do all these things too. It isn't enough to memorize Jesus loves me. We need to think about what that means, and then what that means for the ways we live our lives. May we always have a healthy dose of doubt. May we always honor questions. May we always be a space where others are free to doubt, question, explore, and think for themselves too. May we all be seekers of our own encounters with Jesus. Amen.